By iSCSI protocol stack. The diagram that is shown here, it displays a model of iSCSI protocol layers and depicts the encapsulation order of SCSI commands for their delivery through the physical carrier. So it's a diagram that shows the iSCSI protocol layers and the encapsulation order of the SCSI commands for their delivery through a physical carrier. SCSI is the command protocol that works at the application layer of the open system interconnection protocol. We all know what you mean by the OSI model. So SCSI command protocol works at the application layer of the OSI model. Okay, as we can see that the application layer, the SCSI commands the SCSI command protocol is working. The initiators and the targets use SCSI commands or SCSI commands and responses to talk to each other. The SCSI command descriptor blocks, data and status messages are encapsulated into TCP/IP and transmitted across the network between the initiators and the targets. iSCSI is a session layer protocol that initiates a reliable session between devices that recognize SCSI commands and TCP/IP. The iSCSI session layer interface is responsible for handling the login, authentication, target discovery, as well as the session management. So we have different layers of the OSI model here and the corresponding layers of the protocol that will be applied at the different layers. TCP/IP is used with iSCSI at the transport layer to provide reliable transmission. TCP/IP controls messages, the message flow, windowing, error recovery, as well as the retransmission. It relies on the upper network layer of the OSI model to provide global addressing and connectivity. The layer 2 protocols at the data link layer of this model enables node-to-node communication through a physical network. So that is our iSCSI protocol stack. As we can see, we have encapsulation here. So data is encapsulated multiple times. Okay. So we have the data, we have the SCSI, the iSCSI, TCP/IP and the Ethernet. Well, let us proceed. Let us try to understand what you mean by iSCSI PDU. PDU stands for Protocol Data Unit. A Protocol Data Unit is a basic information unit in an iSCSI environment. The iSCSI initiators and targets communicate with each other using the iSCSI Protocol Data Units, the PDUs. This communication includes establishing iSCSI connections and iSCSI sessions, performing iSCSI discovery, sending iSCSI, the SCSI commands and data, and receiving the SCSI status. All iSCSI protocol data units contain one or more header segments followed by zero or more data segments. The protocol data unit is then encapsulated into an IP packet to facilitate the transport. A protocol data unit includes the components as shown in this particular diagram. The IP header provides the packet routing information to move the packet across a network. The TCP header contains the information required to guarantee the packet delivery to the target. The iSCSI header, which contains the basic header, which is also treated as a basic header segment, describes how to extract the SCSI commands and data for the target. iSCSI adds an optional cyclic redundancy check known as the digest to ensure the datagram integrity. This is an addition to TCP checksum and Ethernet cyclic redundancy check. The header and the data digest are optionally used in the protocol data units to validate integrity and data placement. Each iSCSI protocol data unit does not correspond to 1:1 relationship with an IP packet. Depending upon the size, an iSCSI protocol data unit can span an IP packet or even coexist with another protocol data unit in the same packet. Okay, so that is your iSCSI protocol data unit, which is the basic information unit in an iSCSI environment. Now let us see what we mean by iSCSI discovery. An initiator must discover the location of its targets on the network and the names of the targets available to it before it can establish a session. This discovery can take place in two ways. One way is called as send targets discovery, and the second way is called as ISNS or Internet Storage Name Service. In send targets discovery, the initiator is manually configured with the target's network portal to establish a discovery session. The initiator issues the send targets command, and the target network portal responds with the names and addresses of the targets available to the host. So in send targets discovery, the initiator is manually configured with the target's network portal to establish a discovery session. In Internet Storage Name Service or ISNS, this enables automatic discovery of iSCSI devices on an IP network. The initiators and the targets can be configured to automatically register themselves with a server known as ISNS servers. When an initiator wants to know the targets that it can access, it can query the ISNS server for a list of all the available targets. This is shown in this particular diagram. The discovery can also take place by using the service location protocol or the SLP. However, this is less commonly used than the send targets discovery or ISNS or Internet Storage Name Service. As we can see in this diagram, we have an ISNS server which will be used by the initiator to get the list of available targets. Okay, so we have send targets discovery and ISNS for discovering the targets in a iSCSI implementation. Now let us see what do you mean by iSCSI names. A unique worldwide iSCSI identifier known as iSCSI name is used to identify the initiators and targets within a iSCSI network to facilitate communication. The unique identifier can be a combination of the names of the department, application or manufacturer, serial number, asset number, or any tag that can be used to recognize and manage the devices. Okay, the unique identifier is used to uniquely identify an initiator and a target in a implementation of this iSCSI. Now there are two ways or two types of iSCSI names that is used in to establish connection between the initiator and the target. First one we have is something called as iSCSI qualified name, or in short IQN. The second type of iSCSI name we have is something called as EUI, or Extended Unique Identifier. Let us first try to understand what you mean by IQN or iSCSI qualified name. An organization must own a registered domain name to generate iSCSI qualified names. This domain does not need to be active or resolved to an address. This name just needs to be reserved to prevent other organizations from using the domain name to generate iSCSI names. A date is included in the name to avoid potential conflicts caused by the transfer of the domain names. So an iSCSI qualified name is a registered domain name, okay, that is used by the organizations. The second type of name, iSCSI name, we have is something called as EUI. The Extended Unique Identifier is a globally unique identifier based on the IEEE EUI 64 naming standard. An Extended Unique Identifier is composed of EUI prefix followed by a 16 character hexadecimal name. Okay, so that is one more iSCSI name called as Extended Unique Identifier. Let us try to understand what do you mean by an iSCSI session. As shown in the figure, an iSCSI session is established between an initiator and an iSCSI target. A session is identified by a session ID, we call it as SSID, which includes a part of an initiator ID and a target ID. The session can be intended for one of the following. The session can be intended for the discovery of the available targets by the initiators and the location of a specific target on the network. Or a session can be used for the normal operation of iSCSI, that is transferring data between the initiators and the target. There might be one or more TCP connections within each session. Each TCP connection within the session has a unique connection ID called as the CID. An iSCSI session is established through the iSCSI login process. The login process is started when an initiator establishes a TCP connection with the required target, either via the well-known port 3260 or a specified target port. During the login phase, the initiator and the target authenticate each other and negotiate on various parameters. After the login phase is successfully completed, the iSCSI session enters a full feature phase for normal SCSI transactions. Now it is in this phase the initiator may send the SCSI commands and data to various logical unit numbers on the target by encapsulating them in an iSCSI PDUs that can travel over the established TCP connection. The final phase of iSCSI connection is the connection termination phase, which is referred to as the logout procedure. The initiator is responsible for commencing logout indicating the occurrence of an internal error condition. After the logout request is sent from the initiator and accepted by the target, no further request and response can be sent on that connection. So remember, there are three stages here. One is the login process. The second stage is data transfer in forms of protocol data units. And the final phase is the connection termination phase or the logout process.